Good morning, everyone. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah. It seems I'm audible. Thank you, Divine Ignatius. Welcome, sirs, for the second session of the VAT conference, which we had, one first session we had last week in Abu Dhabi. Today, we have, since 9:30, we are listening about VAT, the basics, concepts, and the special impact, especially in the finance sector. Just if you think about the VAT, you might have thought of it as well, whether it is the cost to the business or cost to a consumer or someone else. Is it a cost to the business? Anyone wants to share? Is it a cost to the business? Yes, sometimes. But the basic concept of VAT is not cost to the business, but in rare cases, it becomes cost to the business, like exempted supplies. Majority of you are from banking sector, so partially it is cost to the business in the exempted categories. And some of the other areas where it comes as a cost to the business, maybe the operation cost or the implementation cost, like software or manpower. Other than that, there are one or two other items wherein it becomes as a cost to the business. Anyone wants to share? Like if someone is not registered for VAT, where their minimum, their maximum threshold limit, 375,000, where in their case it is less than 375,000, they cannot issue a tax invoice. But they will be incurring tax for their purchases or their expenses. It will be cost to them. They cannot recover it. If we incur some tax, even though we are registered, as of now, if we incur tax in KSA, we cannot recover it. And in some of the cases, very rare cases, where we entered into contract in last year and extending to next 2018. So some partial amount of the VAT may become cost to the business. But overall, VAT is not cost to the business. And if we look into the UAE structure, VAT rate, 5% is the lowest rate in the world. And if we take overall our personal cost, the residential accommodation, zero rated or exempted. Local passenger transport exempted. Healthcare, zero rated. Education sector, zero rated. Overall, if we take around 60% of the cost of every individual is zero or exempted, effectively, the effect of VAT cost our day to day life is less than 3%. Today, we have experts here to analyze the impact of VAT on post-implementation. Any law, any tax law, when it comes in any country, three important persons are there. One is, since it is tax, a legal expert is required to analyze. An accountant is required to analyze. And a software expert is required to implement and analyze. We are fortunate here to have all the experts here and one panel. I'm not taking much time because the experts are there to speak, and I want to come to you to get more questions from you. Today's session, we'll be having some question answer session from here itself. Thereafter, we'll be coming back to you to have the very relevant questions from you to give you answer. And we have got a lot of questions through Twitter as well as through emails. We'll try to answer those also. Going forward, I first invite Mr. Shiraz Khan for having an opening remarks for 2 to 3 minutes. Please.
Hello. together, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I just wanted to share some thoughts, begin with sharing some thoughts in terms of the implementation of VAT, what's happened in 2017, and what you guys should be focusing on now. And I also wanted to share some advice in terms of, you know, what you should be doing. So in terms of VAT itself, as many of you know, although it's a tax, it affects the whole business. It affects your customers, it affects your suppliers, it affects different functions within the organization, including legal, finance, HR, procurement, IT. So it has a huge impact across all functions. And many of you in 2017 would have been focused on preparing for the implementation of VAT. In particular, trying to understand your obligations under the VAT law, trying to understand the VAT treatment of specific transactions, whether that's on the sales side or on the purchaser side. Also looking at your IT systems, assessing their capability in terms of what they could do now, what sort of upgrades do you require, do you need a new system altogether. Also on the contract side, you would have had old contracts which straddled the implementation date. So these contracts commenced in 2017 and even before perhaps, and continued on to 2018 and beyond perhaps. So looking at the VAT impact, some of these would have no VAT clauses at all. So how do you manage the risk with your customers and suppliers in relation to these contracts? Also, in terms of the VAT law, the changes would have been required to your processes. So for example, new invoicing requirements were introduced, requirement to raise an invoice within a certain period of time. The invoice is required to meet a certain format. It's required to include certain things on the invoice itself in order for it to be a tax invoice. If you don't have the invoice in that format, you can't recover any VAT. So that was obviously a major change. Also in terms of documentation, most of you would be required to keep documentation for 5 years now, substantiating your supplies and all your transactions. You know, so that includes tax invoices, books, records, credit notes, debit notes, and contracts as well. So of course, the introduction of VAT was a major change, and your focus in 2017 was preparing all the things which I've just discussed. So now we're in 2018, VAT has actually been implemented, and some of you would have filed your first returns in February. Others who haven't filed your first returns in February will either file in April 28th, by 28th of April, or perhaps later if you've had the benefit of an extension of your first filing period. So most of you will be focused on that. And I just wanted to focus on three key messages. My first key message is that VAT is still a new law. So everyone thinks that now the VAT law is here, the regulations were published in November, we magically have all the answers. Unfortunately, we don't. So this is just the beginning. VAT is still a new law. It was introduced only in January. It's only been effective for 2 months. If you look at other countries where VAT has existed for decades, for example, those countries will have practice with tax authorities. Tax authorities will issue guidance, they'll issue circulars, they'll issue notices telling you how things will apply. In addition to that, you'll have case law precedent. So case law precedent is looking at the decisions of the courts. So you could look at the decisions of the courts in the past, how they've decided cases based on similar facts. And this concept of binding precedent is that you could use the previous decisions to analyze how the VAT would apply in your transaction. So this is the idea. Of course, in the UAE, again, we're talking about new law. There's limited guidance available. And the first tax returns only went in. Not everyone filed tax returns in February. So it's going to take some time as the tax authorities audit the VAT returns and they come to views about different transactions. They get experience about different transactions and then they'll be able to share their views. That was my first message, so still some uncertainty. In terms of my second message was about the role of the Federal Tax Authority. I think what I found in the UAE in particular, many people have high standards. You know, a lot of people are relying on the Federal Tax Authority to act as a tax advisor. So they're approaching the Federal Tax Authority, expecting them to give them answers on the VAT treatment for their transactions. You have to remember, Federal Tax Authority, like a tax authority in other countries, is just a tax authority. Its primary role is to administer the tax system, collect the taxes, and enforce the taxes. And of course, they're required to give some guidance, public guidance, general guidance, to benefit everyone. However, they're not there to advise you on specific transactions. And they also have challenges. I mean, the law establishing the Federal Tax Authority was only established in 2000, it was only issued in 2016. The Federal Tax Authority started recruiting somewhere in the middle of 2017. So we're talking about a very new tax authority with very limited resources. So if you call these helplines, you're not going to get all the answers. Which brings me on to my third message. So obviously many of you, in completing your tax returns, you'll be focused on identifying the correct VAT treatment. And for most of you, there will be someone within your organization who will be responsible for VAT. It may be a department, it may be the finance department, it may be the legal department, it may be another compliance department. But ultimately, there will be someone within your organization who's responsible, who's been asked by your organization to actually be responsible for the filing of the return. And the responsibility will fall on that person. So my advice was to focus on risk management. It's important for the responsible department to manage the actual risk. So it's one thing completing the tax return, but you'll be responsible ultimately for the positions taken in that tax return. And to the extent the positions are uncertain, my recommendation is to take some proper advice and document that advice, because this is what you're going to rely on as part of your internal risk management framework. I think that was it from my side as part of the opening remarks.
Okay, thank you. Shilaskar. Now, for the inviting session, for my first question is to Mr. Mike Fogan. Sir, you are experienced in multiple countries, whether it's called as VAT or GST, maybe more than four countries, I think. So, how do you look into the VAT law in the UAE? How simple it is when we compare with other countries? Is it so simple, or can you just highlight one or two areas in possible? How where the simplicity comes here?
First of all, it might be a translation from English into Arabic or Arabic into English. That could be a problem, because the nuances might be slightly different.
Okay.
Basically, the framework's the same.
Yeah.
But everybody's got a slightly different tweak on different activities. I find the constant referring from one article to another to be quite difficult from time to time, and to understand exactly what the law is saying. But when you look at international practice, that's what we tend to go on, and then fit it into the law as best we can.
Yeah. Since there are not much rates, only a standard rate of 5% and zero rate, the complexity of having multiple rates is not there.
It is, but please be careful with your zero rates and your exemptions.
Yeah.
They are very carefully defined, and you've got to interpret them narrowly, not widely.
Yeah.
And that's probably one of the big issues you have.
Right. Thank you. So, the other point which I would like to ask to Mr. Gopal Tyagarajan. Since you are into the software expert, and that is one of the simple softwares available in the market as well, wherein you were mentioning about the coding file. So I understand that some of the softwares already listed with Federal Tax Authority, or some are not, and the business is using different kinds of software. So how they will cope up with the requirement of coding file, whether that is the coding file is available in all the softwares as well, or only the listed coding softwares?
Currently, if you see the VAT VAT return that is being submitted is at the consolidated.
Yeah, the total. Suppose sales mix, it is total of sales.
Yeah. And also, it says that all those returns, everything needs to be netted off.
Yeah.
So you give one figure.
Yeah.
If there is a variation, and if the officer finds that there is a variation, and if he feels that he needs to look into the books of account to determine whether the right tax has been claimed or charged, right? So that is where the federal audit file comes in. So what is the what through the information that they want in the federal audit tax file is basically the invoice-wise detail. with all the components like the supplier name, TRN, date of supply, and all the other aspects. So it is basically a detailed record-wise information that needs to be provided. Now, most of the software should provide that information, and that is where an integrated IT system or an integrated accounting software or a compliance software plays a very important role, such that your accounting information is ported into your compliance information. And since the information is an integrated information, at any point of time you can go back and then extract those information, and those information would definitely be in accordance with the return that has already been submitted.
That means a software is overall, if more information is asked by FDA, a software is overall mandatory it will be, because that massive information has to be collected and submitted to the authority. Yeah, even experienced, so when we submitted the VAT return for refund, we asked for refund for some of the customers. So when we asked for refund, the immediate message came from FDA is that to give the details of the input, customer-wise, and then all the amount, tax amount, as well as the output. Supplier-wise details, TR number of each supplier. So if you are taking the input for any expenses, like any, even in the petrol bill, if you are taking that item-wise, custom supplier-wise details, we have to give. So the further information, when we submitted that one, again one more requirement was there to select some of the transactions and ask for the supporting bill. So as a company, when we maintain the records, we should make sure that all are recorded properly and having proper supporting documents.
And since the requirement of the records and accounts need to be maintained for 5 years.
5 years in the case of foreign business. In the case of real estate, it has to be 15 years. Yeah. Right. So this information have to be maintained for 15 years. My extension of the question is that should we keep the printout of all these invoices or
soft copy is
it should be sufficient, doesn't it? Because
they are the backups are safely
maintained.
So that at any point of time when the FDA requires any information, you can retrieve it and then provide it at ease.
Yeah. It can actually be quite dangerous just holding on to the original because they fade.
Yeah.
So in a couple of years' time you open up the box and the record's faded.
Yeah.
So it would be wise to make sure that you do have electronic copy of all of the documents.
Yeah. As my question is just a continuous question, Robert, as well. So this electronic documents which we get from the suppliers, if the documents are electronically generated, that electronic copy is sufficient, even though signature is not available in that. Isn't it? Mr. Robert.
So yeah. You can accept the electronic copy, you just have to be able to produce all the details of the relevant text from that, if the authorities request one.
Okay.
And obviously, if it's in English, then the authorities can request it in Arabic, and you'll need to then translate
that
into Arabic.
Yeah. Yeah. To Mr. Robert, my another point which I would like to get a little more information is related to Islamic products as well as the conventional banking products.
Mm.
So how it differs, any difference, how it is are covered in the difference between the Islamic products as well as the conventional products?
Yes, so the experience in Islamic countries like Malaysia and obviously here in the UAE law and the KSA law both provide for the equivalent treatment of an Islamic product with that of its traditional financial product requirement. So if it's a moribar or whatever, and it's relating back to just some sort of financing loan or whatever. So the difficulty with that is that I guess it's the profit element of an Islamic finance product that is equivalent to the interest margin on a traditional product. But the Islamic products also have fees and charges. My understanding is generally those fees and charges are quite explicit in an Islamic finance product, so it's easy to identify the component that's going to be taxable, which is the fixed charge, from the profit element, which is going to be the exempt component.
Okay.
So But you need to look at the rules carefully, because obviously in a lot of Islamic products there's underlying buying and selling of commodities. And sometimes the VAT law does not address those buying and selling of the underlying products. Whereas we've seen in some laws, they say that if you are buying products as part of an Islamic financing arrangement, then you disregard the VAT on that transaction. Otherwise, you're having a whole lot of paying out VAT, collecting the invoices, recovering it, and on charging it. So again, it's a case of, as Mike and I have mentioned, you need to read the law carefully, because it's all drafted differently, and you need to see whether or not you need to worry about the underlying buying and selling of commodities that give rise to the Islamic transaction.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So, Mr. Shahzad, in your opinion, what will be the impact of VAT on foreign direct investment into the UAE? Will there be an impact for it?
I think there's going to be an impact of the introduction of VAT. Foreign direct investment, unlike many of you, that impact I think would be a positive one. So if you look at VAT itself, as you know, except your sector and some other sectors, limited sectors, VAT is not supposed to be a cost on businesses. It's supposed to be a cost which should be pushed to the final consumer. So if you're a foreign direct investor looking to invest in the UAE, you'd be looking at what's going to increase your costs. So as a foreign direct investor, as a business looking to invest here, VAT shouldn't be a cost to you in most cases. So I don't think it would affect foreign direct investment, unlike corporate tax, for example. So if you look at corporate tax is a tax on the profits of the business. The business will generate some income, it's going to have some expenses, it'll have a profit. Corporate tax is applied to the tax-adjusted profit. And that obviously affects, that is a cost to the business in operating in the UAE. Unlike corporate tax, and this is one of the reasons why governments tend to like VAT, and it's a very popular tax. And even if you look at some of the trends over the last 10 years, many countries that have gone into recession, in 2008, for example, there was a global recession. Many countries went into recession, they had budget deficits, and most of them reacted to that recession and budget deficit by trying to encourage foreign investment, and tax became a big focus. So during this time, the corporate tax rates went down. You're probably thinking how, you know, because countries going into budget deficit, they want to generate more money, they're doing it through taxes. But the corporate tax rates went down. So the focus became compliance, widening the tax net and compliance to generate the tax revenue, which is basically being lost as a result of reducing the corporate tax rates. But nevertheless, I mean, as I said, corporate tax rates went down, but indirect tax rates like VAT went up. So if you look at the UK, for example, the VAT rate hovered at 15-17.5%, went back down to 15%, then it went up to 20%. If you look at the corporate tax in the UK, it used to be a top rate of 30%. Today it's 19%. Even if you look at some of the countries in the region, like Kuwait, it had a top rate of 55% not so long ago. Now the tax rate, corporate tax rate in Kuwait is 15%. No man, the top rate was 30%. And recently, it's gone down to 15%. It was actually 12% recently that increased it. Even in Qatar, the top tax rate was 30%. It's now 10%. But generally speaking, VAT shouldn't have an adverse impact on foreign direct investment. And UAE remains an attractive market for foreign direct investment, even as a result of the introduction of VAT. So VAT should generally allow the UAE to diversify its revenue and therefore make the UAE more stable economy, which is good for foreign direct investment. And there are some things which impact foreign direct investment, things like, for example, operating here, restrictions on foreign investment, but there's obviously the existence of visas, which allows foreigners to establish businesses with 100% foreign ownership. And free zones also have tax holidays up to 40 or 50 years. As you know, there's no personal income tax. There's no federal level corporate tax. Not yet. And there's no plans to introduce that in the next 3 to 4 years, I think. But it may be under discussion after that.
Thank you.
But there is some Emirates level corporate tax. And 5 of the 7 Emirates levy corporate tax, but it's not on everyone. Although there is a law in place, the tax is actually only enforced for oil and gas companies. And there's separate banking tax decrees under which tax is imposed on foreign banks only. So we're talking about very limited corporate tax, as I said, no personal income tax, and existence of free zones. All of this means that the UAE is still an attractive jurisdiction to invest in.
Thank you, Shaskar. Now, we are discussing here more, but what I'd like to prefer, although we have many questions or many points to discuss here, and we got many questions through email or Twitter, but I prefer to come to the audience to get questions, because you didn't get much chance in morning sessions to ask to the speakers, only one or two questions you were asking. So I'd like to come to you to have any point you need a clarification specifically. So we can have 10-15 minutes that round, then we can move, come back to the panel discussion again. Is that okay? Someone, anybody of you, anyone of you have got any point to raise now from the discussion? What we, yeah, please. Yeah, 1 minute, one speaker. One question is from the back side. Then we will come to you. Yes. It's not audible.
Yeah.
To Mr. Shinas.
Yeah. My question is, you said that the tax credit is not financing from a bank.
Sorry,
just a kind of instruction that from the bank is not probably from the
bank. Can you repeat the question, please? It was not clear.
Hello?
Yeah, now it's sorry.
Sorry. My question is, Mr. Shiraz said that tax should be collected from banks, but the central bank instruction given from IB said that should not be taken from the consumer, should be taken from bank. So, is it correct?
Yeah, I think, generally speaking, the rule is that tax should not be borne by the business. It shouldn't be a cost to the business, the VAT. The VAT is effectively collected by the business. So the business acts as an agent for the tax authority to collect that tax and then account for that tax to the authority. Of course, the idea is that VAT is on consumption. So the business should arguably pass that tax on to the final consumer. It doesn't always happen. It depends on your contracting. So as a business, there is some onus on you, compliance burden, to make sure that you get your contracts right. Although the intention of VAT is that it should apply to the final consumer, but there's still some work for you to do. Of course, there are some sectors which are exempt, financial services being one of them. So margin-based financial services are exempt, and to the extent that the supplies you're making are exempt, there's a limitation on the recovery of the VAT you pay. So to that extent, it can be a cost to your business. Therefore, you have to look at other ways where you could, for example, increase your cost. Now, in the UAE, as many of you will know, on the 28th of December, the Central Bank issued a notice which basically required and requested banks to actually absorb the costs in relation to individual customers and businesses. As I said, the primary way you actually determine that who bears the VAT liability is the actual contract. So a contract will have either a VAT-inclusive clause, they have a VAT exclusive clause, and it's also determined which party will bear the VAT liability. Of course, since VAT was only recently introduced, many contracts in the past didn't have VAT provisions. So the law actually contained some transitional provisions which allowed businesses, generally speaking, the supplier should bear the VAT, and if the contract is silent for VAT, then the price is deemed to be inclusive of VAT. However, there was a transitional provision in the regulations which stated that when the contract is silent for VAT and the customer is registered for VAT and can recover that VAT, the business is allowed to pass on the VAT to the customer. But there was some work for the supplier and the business to do. It wasn't automatic. So before the end of the year, the business had to actually notify the customer, find out from them whether they're registered for VAT or in the process of registering for VAT, and secondly, to what extent they could recover the VAT. If you didn't do that, you can't benefit from these transition provisions. Therefore, you as a business are responsible for VAT. Now, obviously, the central bank notice a few days before the implementation of VAT was in direct conflict with these transition provisions. But I don't think the side of the central bank notice was a final notice. This was just a notice, interim notice, until they finalized their position. So it was kind of like watch your space in this area. But yeah, there was a bit of a conflict. In my view, if you're dealing with a business customer and you're providing some taxable services which aren't exempt, you should be able to pass VAT to them because it's not actually a cost to them if they can recover it. So many banks try to benefit from these transition provisions, but they're basically held off for now because of the central bank notice.
Yeah,
in
exempted case, it will be the cost of the business.
Yes.
The second line, another.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, audible.
My question was, there was a point, place of the delivery. The place of the service, the place of the delivery of the service operation. My question is in relation to the services provided by the UAE banks to the customers which are in the designated zones, or B zones, or the customers who are out of the UAE. If we are providing the services, so what would be the impact of the VAT on those services?
So if I understand the question right, then someone's providing services from the mainland into one of the designated zones. There are no special rules for that. It's a taxable supply or an exempt supply, normal rules apply. So if it's a taxable supply, you'll charge VAT to the person in the designated zone. If it's an exempt supply, then you don't charge VAT. So anyone who's in the designated zone receiving services is treated as if they're in the mainland.
Yeah, that means to the designated zone, it is standard rate of supply. If it is normally the standard rate, if it is overseas, it will be zero rate. So the relevant law will be applicable. So is it the same what you are looking for?
Yeah, I'm looking for both the options that you are providing similar services to customers out of the UAE.
Yeah.
Then you consider Article 31 as to whether you can zero rate that service to your person overseas. There are several conditions in there. It's quite complex, so read it very carefully before you make a decision to go down the zero rate route.
Yeah. Export or services. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah, behind.
Hello. One other question.
Yeah.
Some penalty on the penalties. So can all type of penal fees be excluded from that perspective? And secondly, the tax invoices, can the banks issue them on a monthly basis? Because there is separately, there is no obligation either from the FDA or from the central bank, which means that.
Now, I think Rob raised the question this morning about summary invoices, where you could just issue one invoice per month, detailing all of your transactions and the VAT thereon. That would be acceptable. Your other question, sorry, I didn't quite catch. Something to do with penalties?
Yes. So if a bank charges penal fees, like a late payment fee,
yes,
would this be in the ambit for that or would it be excluded?
Well, if the penalty, sorry. If it's a penalty by nature, in other words, you put in right a harm that's been done to somebody, for example, then it will always be out of scope of VAT. There's no supply by the person receiving.
But the FDA have elaborated a little bit more on penalties. Just because you call something a penalty doesn't mean it's out of scope. The authorities have made it clear that the VAT is a broad-based tax on goods and services, and therefore you would need to carefully be able to convince them that your charge is in fact penal in nature and not in relation to any underlying supply. So some people might say, okay, I haven't paid my rent for the last month and therefore it triggers a penalty clause in the contract. But if I'm still allowed to stay in that premises, then in effect that penalty is really just rent. So you might call it a penalty, but it's not really penal in nature. And the authorities would say, no, 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 that's just rent, it's subject to VAT. So you're going to need to be very careful. Just because something's labelled a penalty does not mean it's automatically out of scope. You need to look to see if in fact there is no underlying supply, as Mike said. So provided it's completely penal in nature and the contract supports that, then yes, you could treat it as out of scope, but I would be very, very careful. The authorities have said they're going to take a very, very close look at anything anyone classifies as an out of scope penalty.
Yeah, this is a continuation of that. I mean, got an email question also related to this. I'm explaining it here. The two questions, one person asked, the second question was, as per FTA, any fee or charges penalty will be nature zero rated. Why many banks offering VAT on penalty charges? Example, so on so on. He mentioned the bank, I just removed the bank name, and so on. So banks collect VAT on penalty charges. So late payment fees as well. So the, as Mr. Robert said, it's, it depends upon the contract, how it is drafted. So we have to look into the case and then we can give it to the...
Because late payment fee could just be an extension of credit, in which case it's an exempt supply. It's not actual. I think all you're doing is letting the person have the money for longer. And that's effectively just an extension of credit. It's not a penalty. It's not penal in nature. The underlying supply is the supply of credit, and therefore that's exempt. So I would not classify that, or I'd be very careful about classifying a late payment as a penalty and out of scope. I would lean towards treating it as an exempt supply, being an extension of credit.
Hi, what I'm from Emirates Islamic. Basically, Islamic banks cannot charge for late payment charges. For wholesale bank clients, we cannot charge interest if there's a penal interest for past due, it has to be given to charity. Now, what are the implications if you have a VAT overdue plus a profit overdue? What would you do in that case?
I guess my view is it's two separate transactions. I mean, one is a banking transaction, and then what the bank does with it afterwards is its own business. That's a separate transaction. You've got a financial transaction with a customer, and there's certain arrangements and penalties or whatever, and then after that, what the bank does with the funds is another issue. I don't think there's any special provision in the UAE law that treats that transaction any differently to any other normal transaction.
Okay, let me just clarify, any Sharia implications for VAT? Like if you have a customer whose past due have gone over 90 days, as per Sharia laws, you cannot charge penal interest, it goes to charity. Now if you have a VAT overdue on that customer, how do you handle the situation?
The Sharia principles work on the system of partnership that they are.
There are various modes of financing.
Well,
it's not like always partnership, it could be ijara.
Yes, but the point of the issue really is whether you're trying to get to the same treatment, whether it's Islamic banking or whether it's conventional Western banking. The two should be the same. How you arrive at that is a matter of a question of often wording. You can't charge interest in Sharia, right? You shouldn't have any gambling elements. All of that sort of thing will be looked at by the committee. But effectively, you're trying to arrive at the same treatment. As Rob said, when you're dealing with loans and selling commodities or items, often those will be out of scope to get to a particular same treatment.
Well, let me get to the exact question. There is a auto finance in a particular Islamic bank. Islamic bank builds the profit right up front. A car of 82,000 dirhams is charged 89,000 dirhams. If profit is built up upfront, that transaction also has a VAT implication. 89,000 becomes 92,000 dirhams. That's recorded as a liability in Islamic bank books. Half an hour 1 year down the road, the customer defaults. It goes into past due. 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, after 3 months, whatever the it goes into non-accrual basis, and all the profit that get accrued goes to charity. Now this transaction has a VAT implication plus a profit implication. I hope my question is clear.
Okay. I think it's one of these things where you need to look very carefully, break down the transaction and see whether the underlying treatment is subject to VAT. And how, always remember, this VAT is not an accounting tax. The way you treat accounting is quite different from the question of whether you're going to pay VAT on something or not. And we've all been down to tax points. So I would have thought we need to look at that fairly carefully. Not answering your question, what VAT is.
Can I answer this question? My name is Mohammed Ayatollah. I am from Dubai, coming back. The issue here is that we talk about that there is a late payment charges and there is a profit, which is the OT. My dear, in your agreement, the late payment charges is mentioned as a late payment. Then it is mentioned that you will collect the late payment charges and then you will pay for the charity. So this is what the board is telling you, that these are two separate transactions. From the customer, you have collected the penalty. On the penalties, there is no VAT, that is exempt. Then what you are going to do is, your bank is going to do is, if they are not paying it to, they are not taking it to the income, they will have to pay it to the charity. So these are two different types of transactions, it's very clear. I mean, there is no doubt in this one. The penalties, the way commercial banks would be dealing with, you will be dealing with the same thing when you are collecting from the customer. What your bank is doing, the commercial banks, they will take it to the income. To the Islamic banks, they will pay it to the charity. That's the second transaction.
So, one more question.
Right.
Then we can have one more.
Hello. I will address my question to Mr. Mike. Yes. Sir, you mentioned something about...
You are from which side? Yeah, okay.
I am from National Bank of Oman. My question is addressed to Mr. Mahal.
Yeah.
Sir, you have mentioned earlier something about the reverse charge mechanism.
Yeah.
Can you further elaborate on that? Because we're not very confident recording something in our books which is not reflected in the invoice.
Okay. Is that
you are asking
to me or?
Mr. Mahal.
Yeah, this is basically an anti-avoidance legislation, but it will apply. When you import services which would have been taxable had they been supplied in UAE, then you have to apply the reverse charge to that invoice coming in from overseas. It's what you're importing a service and you're paying money overseas.
Yes.
The invoice from overseas will not have any VAT on it.
Oh.
Or it might have UK VAT.
There is no VAT in the invoice reflected.
Right, okay, no VAT coming in. Let's say it's in US dollars. You convert that US dollars into AE Durham, and then you do two things from that invoice. It's like an offset through the IT. First of all, you account for an output tax on the 1,000 Durhams you've converted. 5%, 50, you put that as your output. You similarly put 50 into your input and then try and claim all of that back if you can.
So
when you're fully taxable person, it won't matter, it's just an in and out, it washes through.
So both amounts will be reflected in both amount of tax.
Yes, but in the financial sector, of course, some of you will lose the VAT on that input. You still give the 50 to the out to FDA and try and claim 50 back, but you'll end up by putting some into the pot and losing some of it, or it'll be directly attributable and you claim it. But you'll have to go through that apportionment problem.
Okay, so there is a chance that the input tax may not be fully recovered.
That's the problem for the financial sector, yes.
That's why they have the reverse charge, specifically to catch the financial sector to make sure that it is not distorted in terms of whether you buy your services locally. If you buy your services locally in the UAE, that IT supplier would charge you 5% VAT and you would not be able to recover it because you're using it to make exempt supplies. So you would go and buy all your services from overseas, from India or the UK, because they will not charge you VAT and you are better off. So the reverse charge says, no. If you buy services from overseas, you need to self-account for the VAT on that supply. If I pay 1,000 dirhams to an IT vendor in India, I pay them 1,000 dirhams. But when I fill in my VAT return, I need to report 50 dirhams payable as VAT to the government, and then I don't get it back. So I'm in the same position, whether I buy locally or I buy overseas. You lose the 5%. So that's why they have the reverse charge. It's unfortunate that they make everybody reverse charge just to catch the few who are not able to fully recover the 50. In Australia, we only make people who cannot recover reverse charge.
Can we have one more round discussion, then we'll come to you. Yeah, you can hand over,
yeah. Questions are the preferred one. Hi, this is Subhash from Citibank. My question is for either Mr. Mike or Rob. Basically, this is regarding the service fee which we levy on either trade or cash transaction. Basically, we do offer service to our client who may be a UAE resident. But then, indirectly, the payment which the client makes would be to a non-resident who would be our derivator. So when we charge the customer, we have a charge of option of either charging our client or deduct the charges from what is being sent to the beneficiary who is outside. So how would be the treatment of VAT for this? Should we be deducting VAT always to our customer to whom we are servicing, or should be treating that VAT based on who is carrying the cost of the charge for the service?
VAT is levied on a supply by a taxable person to the recipient. Now that recipient is usually the person who is receiving that supply. They might want you or ask you to invoice somebody else for that. And you must be very, very careful if you get into this situation. Because obviously, if you raise an invoice to somebody overseas, you might want to zero rate that. But if you have got a local beneficiary of that service, the chances are even VAT would have to be charged to somebody overseas. So when I go back to the zero rating, just be very, very careful that you are providing your services to the person that you invoice.
As Mike said, there's a provision. I mean, the basic place of supply rules is where the supplier is located. So you're supplying services, the general rule is it's taxable. And then the question is, well, can it be zero rated or is it taxed at 5? So you look at the zero rating provisions, and there's a specific provision in there that says that if you contract directly or indirectly with someone who is outside the UAE, but the services are being provided to someone in the UAE, and that person is not able to fully recover the VAT, then it's not an export. It's taxable at 5%. So you need to carefully look at the export provisions to see whether or not it qualifies. And in that instance, as Mike said, and as I alluded to, it's going to be taxable at 5%. It doesn't matter who you invoice, it's 5%. The danger is that if you're invoicing someone overseas, but the supply is being made to someone in the UAE, and you're charging 5% VAT, then maybe nobody can recover the 5%, or any of it, because the local supplier doesn't have a valid tax invoice from you because you've invoiced somebody else, and they're not registered, so they can't recover it. So everyone misses out.
Except the FTA. Yeah, so it would be ideal to tax my client who is a local customer?
Yes, to the extent that they might at least be able to recover some of it.
I think I just wanted to add one thing to that. The UAE export provisions and this restriction is actually quite generous. So even if you provide services to a recipient who's outside, maybe because you're contracting with them, and someone else is actually receiving the advice here, it allows you to zero rate, provided the person who's receiving the services here can recover VAT. If you look at Saudi Arabia, for example, the provisions are quite restrictive. So in Saudi Arabia, you can't export if the services are being used and enjoyed in Saudi Arabia. So this doesn't quite follow that model, but nevertheless, you still have to establish is someone benefiting from the services in the UAE. It doesn't tell you who the recipient is. So obviously, the primary thing you look at, who the recipient is who you're raising the imports to, who you're contracting with, or maybe someone else is instructed and that person is in the UAE. And you're obviously invoicing someone else, but someone else is actually taking the advice, benefiting from the advice, and they're the ones that instructed you, and they're the ones who you're dealing with. So you have to establish who the recipient is someone benefiting here, and can they recover VAT? So it would be good to ask that question. So it's not as bad as some of the other countries, like I said, which simply require you to establish that it is, or the services being used and enjoyed in the country. And if they are, you stop there and you have to apply VAT.
Thank you. And one more question. So, as a bank, sometimes I act as an intermediary to my customer, and who may be taking some service from an institution which is abroad. So, when the institution which is claiming the fee from abroad, I also pass through the fee, or I just take from my client and give it to the institution which is outside UAE. Do I get accountable for claiming that from my customer and paying it to FDA, or it should be the customer's responsibility to account it in reverse charge mechanism to directly to FDA?
It all depends on the contractual arrangements. It's unclear whether you're acting only as an agent for your customer or not. So if there's a number of transactions, you're providing advice to your customer here, that's one transaction, that's subject to VAT. If there's, in providing that advice to your customer here, you sought advice from someone overseas and you have to pay them, then that's going to be a reverse charge for you. So there's two transactions. One is you buying in the services that you then on charge to your customer. That first leg is going to be reverse charge for you, and the second leg is a taxable supply.
You see the way Rob's working on this? You really have to break these transactions down into their component parts before you get to the right answer. You can't just have a blanket decision one way or another. You break it down and look at the contract. That's what the FDA will do eventually when they're auditing you. If they're not sure on your treatment, they'll go to the contract first. Who are the parties involved? What's the transaction? Who's supplying what to whom? Where's the consideration? All of that you have to look at in isolation.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, one question from there. That's it.
You have to give me a bit more information than that. Where is the cedent?
Yeah, for example, if I have a fee as an insurance company with a reinsurer, and the reinsurer is outside UAE.
So you are the cedent.
Yeah.
You are paying a premium to the reinsurer overseas.
Yes.
Okay, that's a reverse charge.
What if the reinsurer is in UAE?
He will charge you VAT on the premium, if it's not to do with life reinsurance.
And regardless if it's a quota share, for example, or if it's close to 3 million, should I pay for for the whole premium for a claim, or no, only for the amount?
On your portion that he's charging, each one will charge you based on the proportional figure. So first of all, you look at where the cedent is. He's the one who's paying the premium to the insurer. If the insurer is overseas, clearly there's a payment to them overseas. There must be a reverse charge here.
Thank you.
One question here, please.
Hi, thank you very much for the information. I want to go back for the question before that previously about exporting. Because if you have a risk participation in the loan, for example, overseas, then the beneficiary is in UAE, okay, they don't want the loan. So if I risk participation, I have a relationship, legal relationship between me and the overseas bank, and the bank gives it to UAE client who is registered. So, would I have to pay VAT here for the transaction between me and the overseas bank? So, this is a confusing very good for me, because you would pay twice and you would put it on eventually on the client who is in the UAE and registered. So he will treat it as reverse charge, of course, because it's important for him. But it will be double taxation in this situation. Thank you.
So I was just a little bit unclear about the relationship. The situation we were discussing earlier was a case where someone in the UAE contracted with someone overseas, but they were asked to provide the service to someone locally. So in that case, we have a situation where it's not likely to fall in the export provisions if the recipient was not entitled to recover the VAT in full. But if they can, then yes, it's a zero rate export, because as was pointed out, the UAE has got somewhat generous provisions on that respect. But if you are providing, contracting to provide services to someone overseas, a bank or whatever overseas, and that was your arrangement, then that's clearly an export of services. If that bank then provides something back into the UAE, well, that's another transaction. So then the customer of those services from the non-resident bank, they would need to reverse charge. But from your perspective, your contract and your supply of services is to the bank overseas. That's clearly going to be zero rated. So I'm not sure whether I've understood the actual transaction.
No, really clear, because there's definitely grey areas that everyone will interpret the transaction differently. And that's why we hope that the central government would help about doing the, like the KSA, what they did about the services itself, it's subject to tax and all that. I would add furthermore for the article that you mentioned regarding export, indirect or direct, that I just saw that it is for non-resident persons. It's not for resident persons. I just saw it as in the article. Is it? Or it's for everyone, whether resident or not resident.
Yeah, so these provisions are all very complex and difficult, and you need to sit down and work through them. In Australia, there's about 150 pages of guidance from the tax authorities about whether something is an export or not an export. So it's not a simple thing. And here we don't have any precedents, we don't have any guidance. So we do need to rely on people who have experience in other countries. But then we don't know whether the FTA here is going to accept those positions. They may come up with a different position. So unfortunately, until these things get tested, all we can do is take the best advice based on international experience, understand and document the transaction, and file it away. And when an audit comes, the first few years, the audits are going to be very basic, because the authorities, the Federal Tax Authority auditors, know very little about VAT. They'll be just looking for, show us your invoices, show us the contract, They will take years before they understand the complexity of a financial transaction and all the parties involved and be able to ask the difficult questions. So we didn't see that happen in Australia for 3 or 4 years. And then there were more targeted questions and more targeted audits. But for the initial years, the onus is going to be basically on you to document those transactions that are fairly complex, give the reasoning for the position you've adopted, and that way, at least when you come and get audited in 3 years' time and they ask you, why did you do that? You don't scratch your head and say, we don't know. You can pull out the document and you can say, we did think about it. This was what was available at the time. This is the position we've taken. At least that way, you've got a fighting chance with the authorities.
I just had a few things to add. I think you referred to direct and indirect exports. That actually only applies to goods. So for services, in order for it to be an export, first of all, you need services to be provided by a resident here to a recipient overseas. You effectively need the recipient to be overseas, number one. Number two, if the services are provided outside the UAE itself. Number three, the supplier mustn't relate to real estate or other movable assets located here in the UAE. Of course, if you're providing services to another implementing state, and as of now, the UAE doesn't treat Saudi Arabia as implementing state, although Saudi Arabia has actually implemented VAT. Of course, it's quite clear the other four are non-implementing states because they haven't. But from a UAE perspective, in order for the other country to be treated as implementing state, they should also treat the UAE as implementing state, and they should implement the VAT treaty or the framework agreement in full. And from a UAE perspective, Saudi Arabia has done that. Obviously, from a Saudi Arabian perspective, they also don't treat the UAE as implementing state, insofar as the export of goods is concerned. But yeah, in terms of the supplies to implementing state, that all provides the zero-rated treatment. So in the future, once the electronic systems are implemented, and they treat each other as implementing states, then that will be outside the scope of the VAT.
Yeah, one question.
Hello. My name is Ishan from Emerson Summit. I have a question with Mr. Shahzan. VAT is intending to help to improve the economic base of the country. So what measures government is taking to ensure that business don't use VAT implementation as an excuse to increase prices? Because we've been noticing after implementation of VAT, retailers are increasing the prices. But don't you think that it will be likely to impact on the economy instead of a positive impact?
Yeah, I think that is a little bit unfortunate. I think in terms of the introduction of VAT, it was expected to increase prices by about 2-2.5%, although the VAT rate is 5%. And that's largely because for most of us, some of the larger expenses like rent, for example, residential rent, that's exempt. If you look at healthcare, most of those services are zero rated. If you look at education fees, for example, except private higher education, it's all zero rated. So these are some of the big expenses. VAT didn't apply to any of them. So the impact was supposed to be 2-2.5%. Unfortunately, as you said, what some of the retailers have done, they've used VAT as an opportunity to increase their prices. Now from a VAT perspective, there's no issue with that. They can't increase their price beyond 5% on account of VAT. But if they're obviously increasing their price by 10% and saying they'll charge you 10% VAT, that's wrong. If they're increasing their price and if they're going to charge you 5% VAT on that increased price, there's no issue from a VAT perspective. But of course, there may be some other rules that might exist which restrict their ability to increase the price. So they have to operate within that framework. And I think that the federal tax authority have been clamping down on some businesses that have been misusing.
And you need to look at these reforms in terms of short-term and long-term. So short-term, obviously, if you're going to take 2 billion dirhams out of people's pockets, it's going to have an impact on the economy, an impact on demand for goods and services. And then you throw excise in. So if you're a heavy smoker and a big drinker of energy drinks, and you incur a lot of VAT on the food and restaurants and so on, then you're going to have a big hole in your pocket. That's going to impact on your expenditure initially. But the idea is that once we restore confidence in the budgetary position of the region, there will be more investment and therefore more growth. but that's in the short, medium to longer term. In the short term, yes, it's going to have a negative impact. It's just got to, because there's so much money coming out of people's pockets into the government coffers. And there's the one-off inflationary effect. So short term, some pain for a long-term gain. That's the whole objective of this exercise. Otherwise, you wouldn't do it. So, but you need to look at that in that term, that sort of context. That in the long run, in the medium to long term, it's going to benefit the region, benefit investment, higher growth, more jobs, and hopefully higher incomes for all of us.
One guy in my office goes and buys a Prado for one dirham. 1st of January, it's 125. Now, that's five times the rate of VAT, but the problem for the Prado seller, he hasn't got a 5p coin. The lowest is 25. What does he do? He either decreases the size of his Prado. Silly example, but you can see what the problems were in that case.
So there are some questions we got through Twitter also. So after this question, we have got all the Twitter questions as well as the email questions to have a kick.
Yes, sir. Hello.
Hello. Hi, good afternoon. I'm Eddie from Tahap Limerat Insurance Company. As mentioned before, that life insurance is exempted to that. But I just want to ask clarification. How about because there are some benefits like critical illness or partial disability, something like that. So if there's any claim, because these amounts are already fixed since in the beginning when the client signed the contract, the amount there is already stated. So is it subject to VAT when the claim would be like?
You mean on the claim or on the original policy?
On the original policy.
Well, the original policy would be exempt, but you might have some non-life riders attached to it. Right, as you say, medical, accident.
Yes.
If the riders are incidental to the main life policy, I think the FTA might well come down and say, we'll treat that as all exempt, rather than charging VAT on that small part. That's what they did in other countries. They may follow the same rule here.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah, I would agree, especially if there's just the one price policy. It's not broken up separately for the life and the little other components. It's all just one price, and these other things are just incidental, as Mike said. Then there's a good chance they'll treat that as one composite supply of life insurance, which is exempt.
Thank you so much.
We will come back to the next question soon after reviewing some of the bigger questions in past. So these are some of the questions. What a free zone company in the UAE purchasing goods from XYZ company registered outside free zone within the UAE. That means the buyer is free zone company is buying and then suppliers from mainland. Can XYZ charge 5% VAT on this transaction?
Yes.
Yeah, that can be charged. So the argument of the designated zone free zone company is that they are not in the they are designated zone, so it is not taxable. So that argument is not right. The mainland company can charge 5% VAT. So in conclusion, XYZ company should charge 5% to the entity whether they are in free zone or designated zone. Next question is, seller sold goods to the buyer for dirhams 100,000 dirhams. Buyer informed that 250 worth of goods will be returned. Seller issued a credit note for 250. Does he need to reverse VAT collected at initial stage? Initially, how is the treatment of credit note and the import tax offset mechanism? Of course,
yeah. So first thing, you need to issue a tax credit note or credit note, but assuming that's what you meant, then you can reverse it in your next VAT return.
Yeah, right.
As an adjustment.
Yeah, correct. And that has to be a reversal of output. It should not be an input. When we issue the credit note, it has to be a reversal of output.
You should show on the credit note the original invoice number.
Yeah. Another question at this present stage, March 2018, there could be some firms that has not complied with registration, filing of statutory returns, etc. What are the consequences of non-compliance? Please elaborate on the fines and punitive charges. Yeah, 20,000 is the penalty if it is not registered, but as of now we know that the penalty will, any company which is not registered as of now can register before end of 30th April, so there will not be 20,000 penalty because of that. But
yeah, they're playing a waiting game. But this is not a very good waiting game. Okay, no penalties for failing to register, but there will be the tax collected.
Yeah,
and you will not be able to pass that on to your customers because you weren't registered, right? So you couldn't raise a tax invoice. So therefore your customer can't claim anything either. So it's going to be a big cost to you. And you won't be able to claim any input tax on any goods that you may have purchased before you register, especially if they're not on Amazon. So you're going to lose twice. What sort of waiting game is that?
Just to clarify Mike's point, they will backdate your registration to the 1st of January when you should have been, if you were required to have been registered then. And then you have all the VAT obligations. But you obviously have the difficulty, as Mike mentioned, in that you couldn't pass on the VAT, or you didn't pass on the VAT to your customers. So you end up having to pay that out of your own pocket.
And for failure to pay VAT with the time frame, thus the penalty is 2% for the unpaid VAT amount immediately. After 7 days, it will be 4% for the unpaid amount. If it's not paid within one calendar month, after 30 days, there will be 1% per day thereafter. So now we'll go another question. A UAE company is importing goods from Germany. VAT is applicable to the buyer in the UAE. Tax payment is recorded with the FTA. However, the actual VAT payment is deferred till the date of filing the return. But this is already discussed, the VAT reverse charge mechanism in detail already discussed. Export.
Yeah, reverse charge also applies to certain goods imported.
Only if you've linked your customs license with your registration. Otherwise, you will have to pay the VAT to get the goods cleared through customs, and then you'll have to wait till you file your return before you recover it.
Next is, exports are classified as exports to KSA, other GCC countries, and the rest of the world. So, but other, it is not like that, yeah. Please explain the treatment of exports and imports as per VAT rule. What's the logic behind the special treatment given to the exports to KSA by supposed other GCC nations?
I think I already discussed that in the previous question. So if exports are made to a non-GCC country that hasn't implemented VAT, that would be zero rated, provided you satisfy the conditions. If it's made to another GCC country that has implemented VAT, in that case, it would be outside the scope of UAE VAT.
But as of now,
As of now, Saudi Arabia, for the purpose of goods, will treat UAE as a non-implementing state because the electronic system between them hasn't been implemented. And similarly, the UAE will treat Saudi Arabia, both for goods and services, as a non-implementing state because Saudi Arabia is treating the UAE as a non-implementing state.
Yeah. And the next question is related to the invoice. The retailer has a choice to issue a simple invoice, that is simplified invoice, if the sale is less than 10,000, which does not bear the TRN of the buyer, but sale more than 10,000 issues tax invoice as per FTA rules. Please enlighten the logic provisions of the two methods of invoicing.
That needs a little clarification in that you are able to issue a simplified tax invoice to any non-registered business for whatever value. There's no cap. The cap of 10,000 is only if you are making a supply to another registered business. Then you can only issue a simplified invoice up to 10,000. Above that, you have to issue a full tax invoice. But if it's a non-registered business you're supplying, there is no cap. The logic of this is you go to your Carrefour. Just imagine if when you're paying for your goods at Carrefour, they won't issue a full tax invoice. they would have to ask every customer for their TRN, for their name, for their address, and put it on the invoice at the till before they could let you go. And you can imagine the chaos that that would cause. Therefore, governments acknowledge that, and they have provision for simplified invoices where you can leave off the person's name and address and the TRN. So therefore, Carrefour can just issue a document to you, a normal little checkout slip that just has their details without yours. So that's why we have this simplified tax invoice system. That's why we also have a summary tax invoice option. It's just an acknowledgement by the government that there are some practical circumstances whereby it is just not physically possible for you to issue everybody a full tax invoice. And if you find that those special concessions still don't help you in your circumstances, there is provision in the law for you to go to the FTA and negotiate some alternative form of invoicing. So that's still an option for you to do. If you can't comply with the simplified invoices and you can't comply with the full tax invoices, you can go back to them and ask them for some other arrangement.
Since we are discussing on the invoice, one point related to the banking sector itself. There's a question already raised. Some of the banks are issuing the tax invoice at the end of the month, and some of the banks are not issuing the tax invoice. So for a registered person to take input credit, one of the conditions is that there should be a tax invoice. So in that case, practically how the registered person can manage, since all the banks are not issuing the tax invoice. They are claiming that since the tax amount is there in the bank statement, that would be sufficient. That's the relationship manager answers to the SME sector. So, but when we read the law, tax invoices required to claim the input credit. So this is something that's already bank. Maybe I think the bank may be looking into the other banks who have not issued the tax invoice. Maybe looking forward, but subsequent months they may be issuing the tax invoice. Can we expect that? No.
So I think we sort of addressed it so far as. The banks have there might be some confusion initially because in the lead up to the end of January, yeah. People were seeing VAT being charged by the banks, yeah. But no tax invoices.
Right.
One would hope that by the end of that month,
yeah.
The bank would have issued a summarised tax invoice, which should account for the VAT and would allow you to claim the refund. Now, the FTA recently said that those. If you read the law, it sort of suggests that the summary tax invoice has to be issued in the same month, which is not the case. The FTA recently said to us verbally that the summary invoice can be issued after the close of the month, but it has to be dated the month of January, if it's a January statement.
Same calendar month. So emails, 3-4 questions came. Here the evaluation is very simple. In purchase of goods or services, vehicles, fuels, telephone expenses, and all those bills are there. So they mentioned that input tax from purchase amounts to 2,000 dirhams and another expenses 500 dirhams. So 2,500 is the input credit. Output is 3,000 dirhams. So what is how the calculation? So this is the simple calculation. Output minus input. This is the basic formula of the VAT. So we have done the calculation for that for your easy reference purpose. The other question is, as per my understanding, the seller has to collect VAT on behalf of FTA from the buyer. UAE companies importing goods from other nations. Here, since the seller is from outside UAE, the buyer has to pay the VAT on imports, reverse charge already discussed. Both companies located in the UAE, ABN company, ABCN company, an unregistered entity sells goods to the registered firm within UAE. Since the seller is an unregistered and cannot collect tax, does the buyer has the liability to collect tax? So here in UAE, there is no such a reverse charge for the local purchase, normal purchases. So we have given the answer for that. So we will share this. So this is the first one is a very general question. The second one related to what is the impact of claims on reinsurance that we already discussed. Some recent questions. is an affordable solution which can give me not just the VAT invoice but end-to-end solutions to it. That is very general.
That's tough.
Yeah. So you want to give something on it?
So the affordable solution is Tally. It has all the ingredients that is required for SME to make sure that their accounting is taken care, inventory management is taken care, compliance is taken care, and also filing is done. And it also helps their chartered accountants to quickly verify the data and make sure that the data that they are validating are as per the requirement of the compliance. Very simple and easy to use.
So this is the last question we already answered for this one, so will be three papers. Now we can have three more questions. So yeah.
The last one from Admar Bank.
Yeah.
I have two questions about the sector analysis. Number one, that is regarding, we understood from you that any input that paid for the taxable supplies is tradable. From a banking industry perspective, can you think of any examples where we have any input tax paid or directly attributable costs? For example, I thought about syndications, where we pay if we are arranging the funds and paying arrangement fee or syndication fee, that is a direct cost and we are paying VAT on this one. But against this, the supply is our lending. These are the loans, which is a compound. The margin based is exempt, whereas the fees which we earn from the lendings are taxable. So how will treat this one? As a separate directly attributable cost, or it will be in the same unit as of the other common expenses? That was the first question. The second question is regarding the input tax paid for the purchase of assets. Like for example, if my bank's recovery rate is 20%, then the 80% of the input tax is unrecoverable. Should I capitalize it as part of the cost of my asset and start depreciating it, or should I wait for, let's say, 3 months till the time when I will submit the return and then we should start depreciating it? So if you can just throw some light on this aspect as well.
In terms of the 20% that you can, was it 80% is what you can recover?
80% is unrecoverable portion of my input tax, 20% is the recoverable.
Well, the rest of it, you'll expense it in full to your P&L, right?
The rest of that,
yes.
One of the questions that, should I capitalize my unrecoverable input tax, or should I expense it out in my P&L?
You might need an accountant to tell me the answer to that.
I'm not
an
accountant.
Not a bad question, unfortunately.
And if let's suppose that it has been capitalized and we are capitalizing it, so should we capitalize it on the day of payment for that asset, or should we wait for 3 months when I will be submitting my returns? That day I should capitalize the timing of the capitalization.
Sorry,
we're
not accountants. I'm sure there's accounting rules that tell you what you can and can't do, and IFRS has also imposed some other conditions about when you need to recognise revenue and expenses and so on. So I would just take guidance from that. Sorry, this is not that question. I don't have the expertise to answer on that question, I'm afraid.
For the fixed asset, when we acquire the eligibility in general, the fixed asset, when we acquire, it will be on the current tax period the input credit can be taken. When fixed asset is acquired, input credit can be, the eligibility of input credit is in the current tax period. So when we acquire, physically acquire, then that will be the date on which, on that period, we can take the input credit.
The first question, it's not easy. Sometimes to get an input tax only relating to a taxable supply in the banking sector.
If you got it related to a zero rated supply, that would be fine. If you were providing that service to somebody overseas, the input tax then could relate to your overseas activity if you're zero rated. But several of my clients have found this very, very difficult, such that the POP calculation is almost nil. That's why this formula is not very good for the financial sector. The attribution is not easy when you're looking at the activities that you undertake.
What would tax we are paying for our syndications, like arrangement fees, syndication fees, so we should take it to the common pool and then we should apportion it.
Well, if you're charging a fee for the syndication,
yeah. Then
that would be taxable. Any input tax relating to that, you could therefore recover it in full, if it relates to the syndication fee per se.
Syndication, what we are arranging and syndication where we are lending, these are not mutually related.
Okay, well, if you're lending, then you have more of a problem, right?
Yeah.
Not easy, this, and a very bad formula, in my opinion, for the financial sector.
Yeah, one question in the front line, just in front of you. Sales or total service for a period of 12 months backward. If you are checking, for example, if you are checking this January whether you are taxable or not, you have to check in 2017 the total sales crossing 375,000 or not. If it is not crossing, then one more checking you have to do whether next 30 days the sales will go more than 375,000 or not. If any of the situation, you have to register, it is mandatory.
Yeah, this was my question. Yeah. Who has to take that initiative? We have to take that initiative?
Of course. That small business has to take the decision. Yeah. And subsequently every month, we have to check that one, whether previous last 12 months exceeded 375 or not. In any particular month, we exceed, immediately we have to register for the VAT.
I think just a point I wanted to add on that is a taxable turnover. So if it's exempt, then that doesn't count towards the threshold. You have to look at the taxable turnover over the past 12 months, or the annual taxable turnover over the next 30 days. And I think that even, for example, you don't meet that threshold, there's actually a lower threshold of 187,500. And if you meet that threshold, either in terms of revenue or expenses, you can register. You don't have to, you're not required to, but you can register. Why would you do that? To allow yourself to recover VAT on the purchases. Obviously, any purchases that you make, you will pay, most of them, you pay VAT. If you're not registered for VAT, you can't recover VAT. Some of the smaller businesses, although they don't meet that 375,000 threshold, even through expenses, if they meet the lower threshold, then they can register and recover VAT.
That is for the company. Even when we look into the individuals also, in case the revenue of the individual, taxable revenue of the individual also exceeding 375,000, it is mandatory for them to register. Like in a real estate revenue, the property revenue, if it is not registered as a company, if the property is in the name of individuals, then they have to register if it's a taxable. That means commercial property revenue. Or any manager corporation, if it is exceeding 375,000 for an individual, then as an individual also they have. Yeah, one more question. Again, this will be the last question from the audience. Yeah, yes.
I actually wanted to elaborate a little bit more to where the gentleman said about the negative effects of consumption. Do you think we're underestimating the effect of that 5%? It looks small on paper, but we need to acknowledge it.
Can we change the mic?
Can you? That 5% is actually based on amplified price. Can you get out of that? Period. So we as GCC countries use the excuse that we're tax-free for the past 20 years to amplify prices of goods and services until they become very close to Europe, and putting into consideration Europe had a 22% tax. So with that 5%, we're way higher for, let's say, at least if we're going to be talking about luxury goods and what so. Do you think that we're underestimating the negative effect of that 5%? This region used to be very cheap to live in. It's pretty expensive, right?
I think the only thing I'd say that it is just a 5%. So I know in terms of some of the costs in the region, they can be higher than other countries, even without VAT. If you talk about relative terms, it's only 5%. And in terms of the impact it has on people, I think in most cases, people have their habits and they like to spend on certain things. I think in most cases, a 5% increase won't hinder them in terms of making the purchases. I think in some cases, it can have an impact, but generally speaking, I don't think so.
Thank you. On behalf of the panel, I thank you, Embrace Institute for Banking and Financial Studies for the MSc project, and mainly the participants who made this discussion very effective, very meaningful, and exposed City has given the clarification for the questions and their insights and their experience and everything. Thank you. Thank you so much.